HarperCollins presents Scuttle by Barnaby Walter, read by Francine Brody, Frazer Hadfield, and Mark Elstob. Prologue. I dragged the body through the darkness, kept it close. Leaves, blood, screams. It's screaming, it's screaming, it's waking. Wrap it tight, bind it tight. It mustn't escape, must bind it, wrap it, bind it tight. Part of my mind could make out the shouts, the shrieks in the night, getting nearer, but my thoughts were far from clear. There was a quaking in that side of me, an energy pushing me on, pushing me to do terrible things, things that would otherwise sicken me. It's moving, it mustn't escape, tie it up, bite it, bite, bite. I registered another shout without understanding what it meant. It was like I both heard and felt it, like the sounds were vibrations I could pick up on, decode, without having to hear the words. I couldn't think about things clearly, even though I tried. Tried to hold on to the thoughts I knew belonged to me, to the proper me, the part of me that knew what I was doing. Feed, 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 feed. Part 1. Awakening. Chapter 1. The Boy. 25th of October, 2024. I woke up breathing hard, my heart pounding, the duvet on the floor. I was cold and hot at the same time, my arms and legs twisted around a bundle I was clutching onto. My pillows, both of them, twisted and clumped into one mass. I pulled them apart, punching them back into a more pillow-like shape, and returned them to their normal spot and laid back. I'd had a dream, a nightmare, but I couldn't remember what it was about. The feeling, however, was still there, lingering in my mind like a dull ache, as if from a wound that hadn't quite healed. A horrible sound cut through the darkness of my room, screeching, mechanical. Violent, almost. I sat up, swung my legs out of bed and stood, listening. It was coming from the garden. I went over to the windowsill and looked out, blinking in the grey morning light. It was that prick from next door, Eddie the quad biker. He was strimming his lawn at 6:40 on a cold October morning. That was the kind of guy Eddie was. Didn't give a fuck about anyone else. Just did his thing. There were only two other houses on our little country road, and we were unlucky enough to be saddled with him as a neighbour. I pulled the curtains open. My floor-to-ceiling bedroom window was cut in two, with a rim that allowed you to open the top half outwards. On this small ledge, I could see something moving. A small money spider running across it. I wasn't sure why, but I decided it should be freed, so I opened the window to let it out. That was when Eddie looked up from over the fence.
Ah, sorry to wake you, mate,
he called up, grinning, as if he was pleased someone had noticed how productive he was being at that time of the morning. I frowned down at him and nudged the money spider out of the window. It didn't seem to want to leave my hand, so I gave it a firmer push and it made its way down the outside of the glass. You awake, Hudson? My dad's voice sounded from the corridor outside my room. Yeah, I replied. He opened the door and looked in. Bloody Eddie with his strimmer, he said, nodding at the garden. He woke me too. I shrugged and sat down on the edge of my bed, looked at my feet, brushed aside an abandoned paperclip on the floor with one of my toes. I was pissed off. I hadn't forgotten the argument we'd had the night before, an argument that started with a heated discussion about plans with my friends on Halloween and ended up with a row about how suffocating Dad could be. He'd reminded me that at least he was here and not living in America like Mum, but if I thought she'd be a better parent, perhaps I should talk to her more rather than avoiding her calls. He had a point, and that was what had hurt. I had been avoiding talking to her. I just didn't get the point. If she was going to live her life so far away from us, why should I bother making the effort? I wasn't in the mood to go through it all again now, with a school day stretching out ahead of me, so I just stayed silent. Eventually, Dad asked, "Why's your duvet on the floor?" I shrugged again, letting out a sigh. Fell off in the night. He was silent for a few seconds. Then he said,
Well, get dressed. I'll make us breakfast.
I spent a minute or two staring out of the window, finding it hard to motivate myself to move. From my seated position, I could no longer see Eddie, but instead had a far-reaching view across the fields that our houses backed onto, fields that ended with a few more houses and some trees. The trees that formed Barrett Forest, swaying in the distance. Eventually, I forced myself to get up. I showered quickly, then pulled on my school uniform, not bothering to do up my top button or fasten my tie. In the kitchen, I slumped down on one of the chairs at the kitchen table, dropping the bag containing my sports kit carelessly on the floor, and took a slice of toast off the plate in front of me.
Morning,
Matthias said, looking up from his iPad. I grunted in response, knowing it would annoy Dad. Perhaps he was keen to avoid another shouting match, but he chose to say nothing. But I saw him and Matthias share a look. Since their wedding a few years ago, I had waited for Dad and Matthias to drift apart, for me to be proved right that Dad marrying a much younger man, someone closer to my age than his, was simply an early midlife crisis. But they hadn't drifted apart. Things had stayed the same, and I'd had to face up to the fact we were stuck with him.
Have some fried eggs,
Dad said, tipping two onto my plate without waiting for an answer. There was something about the way they collapsed in on each other, a drip of grease sliding off the top of one, that killed any hunger I might have had.
Kenny will be here in a minute, I replied.
I saw Dad's smile morph into something stiffer, less relaxed. He wasn't a fan of Kenny. Considered him a bad influence. Probably right, but I wasn't about to stop hanging out with him because of it.
Is the party in the woods on Halloween Kenny's idea? Matthias asked, setting aside his tablet and helping himself to eggs from the pan.
I noticed Dad's head jerk up. He gave Matthias a short, sharp shake of the head and glared at him. It was obvious what he meant. Let's not bring all that up again. Yes, I said simply. Matthias clearly thought he needed to prove he was on my dad's side.
I think your father's right to be concerned. The woods at night can be a dangerous place, especially Barrett Forest. You know, you barely get any phone signal in there, it's so thick with trees. It's normal for parents to worry.
It was my turn to frown at him.
Well, it's lucky you're not a parent then, isn't it?
I said bluntly, deliberately to wound, and I saw the hurt in Matthias's eyes. I felt bad afterwards, but the fact he was always trying to be friendly rubbed me up the wrong way.
Don't talk to your stepfather that way, Dad said, and don't start with that tone this early in the day.
I'm not starting with a tone, I snapped back. If parental concern was so fucking important, maybe you could bring that up with Mum when she next tries to get in touch. Maybe then she'll realise choosing pills and alcohol over me wasn't such a great move.
That's unfair, Dad said. Your mother has... had... her difficulties.
I know, old news, Dad.
And like I said last night, I appreciate it's been difficult for you.
I think we should see her wish to be in contact more often as, well, a positive sign. I got up and left the table, picking up another slice of toast as I went.
Hudson, please sit back down, I heard Dad say, trying to sound reasonable, but I didn't reply.
Tugging on my school blazer from the hook in the hallway, I grabbed my rucksack and opened the door. Kenny stood there, his hand raised, about to press the doorbell.
Perfect timing, Kenny said, smiling.
Dad didn't like Kenny's smile. He said it looked as if he was always smirking. It was one of the many things Dad would criticise Kenny about. I suppose he may have had a point, but since I wasn't one for smiling much at all, it was probably best if I didn't judge.
Hudson, a voice called from down the hallway.
I turned and saw Matthias walking towards me, clutching something.
Here, you forgot this, he said, holding out the sports bag.
Oh, yeah, thanks, I said, taking it from him. It made me feel bad for getting cross with him earlier. He was nice, even if I found him annoying sometimes. But I knew I'd have found whoever my dad had chosen as a partner annoying. I said goodbye, offering him a small nod, hoping he'd take it as an apology. As soon as the door had closed, Kenny shook his head and said,
I still think it's weird every time I see him, your dad being with a guy so young.
This was something Kenny often said,
and I thought it might have something to do with the fact his own father had had an affair with his much younger secretary. The typical tacky cliché, in Kenny's words. But in the end, had decided to stay with his age-appropriate wife and make it work. I wondered if Kenny's comments about my stepfather's age were because my dad had found love with a much younger partner, not through an affair, but rather a relationship that had led to marriage. I offered one of my usual responses. "There's only 18 years between them," I said. "It's not as much as some couples." In truth, there was closer to 19 years when all the months were taken into account. My dad was 41, and Matthias had only recently turned 23. "You and him are practically the same age," Kenny said, as we turned the corner onto the main road that led up to North Woodingham Secondary School, or as we like to refer to it, the prison. "Yeah, I know," I said, tired of the subject now. "I mean," Kenny used his fingers to work out the sum, "he must have been, what, 6 or 7 when you were born? And now he's like your second dad? Madness." I stayed silent for a while. When Kenny had first voiced something like this, I'd wondered if there was an element of homophobia behind it, and whether he would have commented on it had Matthias been a woman. But since becoming friends when I joined the school a couple of years ago, he'd never said anything obviously anti-gay, or at least not in my earshot, so I ended up pushing this aside. One of my dad's pet hates was what he called imagined discrimination, and he said it was usually best not to presume the worst in someone. He felt that attitudes we often rush to condemn as rooted in hatred are often actually more innocuous and sometimes come from a totally different place. "An emotional response is a valid response," he once said, "but it doesn't mean it's the correct response. Just because you feel something doesn't make it real. Becoming emotional clouds the brain. Always remember that getting angry and upset can lead to rash behaviour, and rash behaviour can lead to the wrong choices or conclusions." Kenny eventually moved the topic of conversation onto the Halloween party. He was the mastermind behind it and had spoken of little else since. "It's gonna be wild, mate. Wild. Loads of girls coming, including Kirsten. Your special, beautiful Kirsten." He said these last two words in an exaggerated Irish accent, presumably in reference to the light Belfast edge Kirsten spoke with. He nudged my shoulder when he said the name, his meaning clear. Kenny thought I fancied Kirsten, and if I was honest with myself, he was kind of correct, although I'd never said it outright. I wouldn't trust him not to go and tell Kirsten, or anyone else he came across for that matter. "Just fucking talk to her. You never do. Just moan at me about how you like a flowery perfume. You need to lose this whole virginity thing at some point." He flapped his hand, as if the whole concept of being a virgin was a silly new fad he didn't believe in. "Trust me, I want to, I just..." I trailed off, unable to finish the sentence properly, embarrassed to say that I found talking to girls terrifying. When it came down to actually doing it, I'd be right there, ready. It was just the bit that came before it, the awkward chat, the trying to ask them out on a date or letting them know you'd like to spend time with them at a party. All of it was a massive mountain of stress I had no hope of climbing. "Last time we went to the woods, Charlene gave me a handjob behind a tree," Kenny said proudly, as if it were his life's achievement. "I know, I was there." I set my mouth in a grim line, remembering the heart rate quickening mixture of embarrassment, fascination, and white hot envy when I'd seen Charlene unzip Kenny's jeans and push her hand inside as she kissed him. "Fucking classic," he grinned. "I'm sure she'd do you too. I'll ask her." "No, don't," I said straight away, mortified by the idea. "Fine. Just come to the forest. It wasn't a problem last time, so I don't get why..." "Because that was on a Sunday afternoon in summer. Now it's dark, there's practically no light, and it's much colder." This made me sound like a child, and I was well aware we were in the middle of a surprisingly mild autumn. "I'll have to see," I added vaguely. My dad wasn't particularly pleased when I brought the idea up. Kenny shook his head, his mouth in a grimace. "Your mistake is to always ask for permission. Your dads need to get to grips with the idea that little Hudson is now big Hudson. You're going to be 18 in, like, just under 2 years." "Well, 2 years can fly by. After school, just go home and tell them you're going. Or better still, Don't bring it up at all and just sneak out. I'd thought about this already. I could sneak out. I'd never done it before, but something about the thought made me feel reckless and excited.
Come on, just do it,
Kenny said. Halloween night in the woods. It's gonna be...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.